This is a Literary License Podcast. 2-for-1 episode coming at you from the UK and USA with your hosts, John Wilson, Vicky Ray, and Keith Chorgo, discussing films that change your life from comedy to horror and everything in between.
Piss your pants.
Piss your pants.
I said, piss your pants. My sister, Martha. Martha, these girls, want to buy some grass.
And the road leads.
Shall I just take a little drink?
No, don't do that. Just
and the castle stays the same. And the father tells the mother,
it's not little, you just can't get some.
Welcome to Literary License Podcast, and today we'll be discussing Last House on the Left, directed by Wes Craven from 1972, and Big Driver, based on a short story by Stephen King that came out in 2014. And before we get started, let's find out who's with us today. And we have, of course, our regular co-host, Vicky Ray. Say hello, Vicky.
Hey, everybody. What's up?
And a regular co-host for our 2-for-1 episodes is back, John Wilson. Hello, John.
Hi, folks.
And nice of you to join us finally, John. People are wondering where the hell you are.
I missed you, bitches.
We miss you too. And clearly some of our fans are missing you too, because we've been told.
So. Oh,
yeah.
I miss them too.
So before we get started, let's figure out what each and every one of us has been up to. So, John, what have you been up to since last time we spoke to you?
I just finished New York Comic Con. What? It was amazing. There are so many, like I was just telling you guys, so many talented people, so many creative, very cool costumes. It's a little intoxicating because when you go, there's just so many people there. So I usually get there like midday and then I leave like around 4 or 5. You just feel drunk on all the energy that's in the room. I mean, there's just so much going on. Yeah, you can't even focus sometimes because you're like, I would look at something and they're like, oh, what's that? Oh, what's this? Oh my God, what's that? And I would just, you know, I had to sometimes take a moment where I'd sit and not look at anything because I was just like kid in a candy store.
You sound like Dory.
I'm like a kid in a candy store. I was like, oh my gosh, what's going on? You know, so it was so much fun. I love it. It's my 4th year doing it. So, you know, it's pretty cool.
Did you make any purchases that we should know about?
Yeah.
I did, actually. I have some prints that I have to take pictures of them and post them on our page, but I got some really cool prints. There's one that I walked up and there's an artist who he does kind of like these caricatures, and he did one of Stan Lee, and I literally like started crying. I was like, okay, this is making me cry, so I'm purchasing it. So I'm going to take that. And I'm going to take my tears and walk away. but I did a few prints, and then I got like a little from Zelda Midna stuffed, like hand stuffed doll that was created. This brilliant artist does, and she does like, they're all unique. So, you know, it was really cool to kind of purchase something like that. And like, no one else has this. So it's pretty cool.
Sounds like a riot.
So I guess we could say that John escaped from his nerd herd and he's hopefully safely back with them.
Yeah. I left the mothership and I'm back here.
And what about yourself, Vicky? What have you been up to?
Oh, just getting ready for family stuff and that silly season coming around the corner. Asher's going to Grands in Tulsa, and I started watching because it's Revenge Month here, and I kind of went crazy with the I Spit on Your Grave series stuff. And I started watching The Haunting of Collinwood with Quentin, and that was like a 3-hour thing. I'm still not finished with that. And I watched this movie, Horns, with... It was weird.
Daniel Radcliffe, right?
I kind of enjoyed it. I didn't like the ending, you know, but I enjoyed it. Yeah. And American Horror Story is kind of losing me this season.
Yeah, I agree. It's kind of jumping. It's not scary, you know.
No, I'm really kind of disappointed. The writing kind of sucks. People don't hurt me, but
I felt that way. I think this week's episode gave it a slight turn. That piqued my interest a little bit, so I'm quite interested a little bit more. But I do think, personally, with this American Horror Story 1984 season, I think they kind of missed the boat. It should have been an ode to all great things of 80s, and that means like an ode to the great 80s slasher films and the 80s horror films.
Yeah.
And, yep. You know, whether it's Night of the Creeks, or you're looking at the Friday 13th Halloween's, Nightmare on Elm Street's, or even some little ones like Critters or things like that.
Something.
And even the soundtrack music for the opening credits irritates me a little bit, because it's kind of like, because they could have used the same tune that they've done, given like a slight 80s flavor to it.
Well, I think they're trying to give it an 80s edge, but it's not coming, because we're all children of the 80s here, and it's not like coming across as 80s as I remember, you know.
And the thing that I don't like about the series too is that they are trying to connect everyone together, and they're trying to use these weird backstories as to why, and I don't think I need to have a connection with every single person, and so it gets frustrating, because I'm like at a point, I'm like, okay, who else is connected to this? Like, you know, it just gets to the point where every person has some sort of hidden secret, you know, hidden.
Right.
And 80s horror films wasn't about that. It was just,
And they're showing
slasher.
The killers.
Yeah. And I don't understand why using a real life serial killer that actually was, you know, he actually was murdering people around this time period in real life, and why they put him in this fictionalized setting, because it kind of leaves it a bit unjarred. It gives kind of like, what's he doing there? Because the history of the Night Stalker, you know, right. His crimes, you know that he was on the dating game as a contestant.
Yeah.
But, you know, and then you kind of like, well, you know, and another thing is like, and whatever good thing about 80s horror films is that when you ever had a chase sequence in an 80s horror film, they always had some fantastic music, whether it was the Halloween chase music or the Friday 13th music or Nightmare on Elm Street. And they don't have that here. And there should be like something that would set this apart, because that's what 80s slasher films were. And, you know, I think
it's supposed to be the jingles for, you know, jingles. Like, that's supposed to be the creepy, you know, elements. And I'm like, it's not really creepy to me.
Well, no, it's just a freaking set of keys, isn't it? And I mean, it's like being scared of your school janitor at school, you know, get locked in the school after hours. It's not really that scary. You just don't go down to the basement.
So we did have a creepy janitor in Watertown High School. We used to call him Lurch. And for all my friends that are out there listening, you'll know exactly who I'm talking about.
Well, we had one. His name was Chicky, and apparently he was like a pedophile. But if you showed him your underwear, you'd give him a quarter. So we used to show him our underwear, and he'd give us a quarter. We'd go down to the store and buy tweets.
You did not.
We did too. That's what we did.
Oh my God!
You freak.
It was. Why not? He's not touching you. A quarter.
You gave him a quarter to show him your underwear.
Yeah. Name is Chicky.
Something wrong with you. Something very, very wrong with you, Keith. I've known it, but now I'm...
Oh, it wasn't just me. We all did it.
Was his name Freddy?
No, his name was Chicky. I don't know what his real name was.
Chicky.
There is folklore around Sackett's Harbor about him. And I mean, he's passed now, poor guy, but... But he never touched any of us. It's just like, but you know, it'd be like,
I'll sort of like underwear. The bloody James.
If you give me a quarter, I'll show you my underwear, and you give us a quarter.
Sort of like the bloody Jake stories in Portage Street.
But do you know? But do you know how much candy you could buy for a quarter in those days?
Yeah, oh, that's true.
Penny candy.
Oh, precisely. Yep. You know, you could buy two candy bars.
There's this lady that was called Leapies. It was on Luray Street. We used to get all stoned and shit and go buy penny candy. She hated our asses so bad. Poor woman.
Yeah. So, but I mean, as far as American Horror Story is concerned, I have a feeling that it does feel like, you know, when sometimes they say they're going to make like a redo or a reboot of an 80s film and they kind of go, oh, we love this, you know, we love this product and we love the 80s and they're fantastic. And then when you kind of see it, you realize they know nothing of the 80s and it kind of feels that way, you know.
Well, and they also, again, they try to give too much depth to the characters. In the 80s, the characters were like caricatures, right? You know, you had the dumb buxom girl, right? You have the dumb jock, you know, like there's so much, they just add so many layers to the characters that it's like that wasn't 80s horror. 80s horror was just people making really bad decisions, like, you know, I'm gonna go get stoned, man, I'll be right back, you
we're
know,
gonna
like,
go just, have just, sex just, even though there's a murderer yeah, we're running gonna have around sex.
Yeah, there's and it's I, just and too I much to
it's pretty sad when the 70s storyline is more exciting than what we're watching.
Yeah.
You know, that the first 10 minutes of the first episode is probably the most exciting.
Yep. Yeah. I'm going to see what happens next week. I mean, like I said, there's a new twist.
I invested in it. I'm not throwing it away. I'm not like,
me neither.
Sick of this shit. I'm not going to watch anymore. I am interested. And it did take a slight turn that did pique my interest.
One of my favorite seasons was Roanoke. I still love that season. It was such a great season.
I liked Asylum and Coven. Coven was by far my favorite. Asylum being second. Yeah. But I mean, it just, they're not holding that, I don't know, something about Coven kept making me run back every week to watch it. And Asylum was just brilliant. Mm. But I mean, I don't know if they got the same writers or if they're just cheaping out on us or what's going on.
I got a feeling they probably hired a bunch of millennials who are watched a bunch of 80s films but didn't actually live it. I think it's probably more of that.
Yeah.
You know, people who are looking at, oh, I love the 80s but never actually lived it. So, you know, maybe that's it. So anything else, Vicky? Anything else you want to report on seeing?
Nope. I started watching The Walking Dead. I'm not going to throw that one out yet. I want to see what they're going to do with it. And they have I did watch the trailer, and people under 30 are going to hate me, but they got a millennial Walking Dead coming out in the spring of 2020. Yeah. It's like, I don't think I'm going to do that to myself. Not going to do it.
I just think that it's like, it's so absurd because it almost is like, it looks almost like Lord of the Rings because we're going to go on an adventure outside the walls to see what life really was like. I mean, it's so fucking stupid. It's so dumb. And it's like you get all these zombies who are now like, they're basically don't move. They're like stuck to a car. You know,
where's the fun in that, man?
In 10 years, like the zombies technically should be dust at this point. Like there's nothing that should be left that should be like, there's maybe one or two that you just, you know, stab and kill. Like I don't even know how they can keep it going. Crazy.
No, I think they're beating a dead horse now.
Yeah.
Well, I think the zombie thing's probably had its heyday as well. They probably should lay off and try to look for something slightly different or a new way to approach it. Maybe.
Well, Andrew Lincoln's supposed to be making Walking Dead movies now, and that's what's going to come out because they really didn't get rid of him. And Maggie, oh gosh, Cohen, she's coming back in season 11 because Whiskey Cavalier just wasn't cutting it on primetime. So.
Yeah, it didn't last. It was not. It was one that I knew wasn't going to last. You know.
So she's coming back to the fold. I don't know how they're going to rewrite her back in, but she's coming back, and a lot of people are excited about that. So we'll see what happens.
And for myself, I've been watching Creepshow, the TV series that's on Shudder.
I thought the last one was really good with a little girl. She was actually in The Walking Dead. That one I really liked.
Oh, the Dollhouse. Yeah, I mean they're going. I think the third episode's out now, so
I haven't watched it yet.
And that's very, very good. I like the way that they tie in the 80s films and they kept the format and you could tell that the people who did this really have a love for the source material. And of course, you know, some stories are going to be stronger than others. It is an anthology series. What's quite good is that they're doing two short stories in each episode. So if one doesn't pick your fancy, normally the second one will. And
I've liked them, except it was really gross. The gray, whatever. The guy was drinking the beer.
Oh yeah.
That one just was so disgusting.
Well, I have something to say that they're bringing him back. They have a lot of classic 80s horror film actors. Jeffrey Combs is in episode two from the Reanimated series.
Yeah.
And you're seeing a lot of familiar faces, which is quite good.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it.
And then on Netflix, I watched the Stephen King and Joe Hill short story film called In the Tall Grass, which I'm undecided.
Either loved it or you hated it.
I'm not too sure. I didn't love it or hate it. I'm kind of really undecided. There's parts of it that I loved, and there's parts of it that I think they kind of went up their own arse with it. It's a bit like watching a Matrix sequel. Yeah, it's not horrible. I think it's filmed beautifully, and there's a lot of good things in it. Some really good performances in it, but there's something that doesn't quite gel. The beginning of it's fantastic, but there's something that's not gelling in the middle for me. So I'm probably going to sit back and rewatch.
I've been watching a lot of the reviews. I haven't started watching it myself, but a lot of people aren't really happy with it. They said I haven't started it, so I don't have nothing to go by but I'm reading.
Well, I read the book, and the book is very good, but it is a short story. It's kind of like what they've done with Children of the Corn. Children of the Corn was a fantastic short story, but then when they made the movie, they had to elaborate on it to make it into a full 90-minute movie. And that's where
often they do that with King's work. They elaborate too much.
Yeah.
Well, they are redoing The Stand. I can't wait to see that. I guess the guy from True Blood, played the head vampire.
I can't wait for Dr. Sleep to come out because that looks good.
Oh, I saw the coming attractions for that. Yeah, I'm actually looking forward to that one. Yeah.
And let's see what else. Also on Netflix, Insatiable came back for season 2, so I'm watching that at the moment. I quite like that. It's kind of stupid humor. RuPaul's Drag Race UK is playing here in the UK.
So can't go wrong with RuPaul.
Which they've done. It's interesting watching the UK version of it, but RuPaul's here. Michelle Visage is here. So they're doing that at the moment. So that's quite interesting. Isaac likes that. And I watched the new Batwoman series, the first episode of that, which was interesting, a lot of politics being played in there, you know, gender politics, but it's interesting. It's piqued my interest. I am interested in another episode of that. And been watching Tiny Houses Netflix. What else have I done?
Tiny Houses.
But I tell you what's really good, and I suggest everyone does watch this, is it's called Level 16 on Netflix, which is a fantastic horror film. It's really, really good. I don't want to give too much 16. Away, but I highly recommend
16,
it.
Level 16, okay.
Is that Netflix, sweetie?
Netflix, yes.
Yeah.
So that's very, very good.
I was going to say, I watched the last season of an Australian series called Glitch.
Oh, yes.
And really I didn't like the ending, but I guess now looking back on it, it had to kind of end the way it ended, but it was such a great series. It's about people who come back from the dead. So basically, these people come out of their graves. A police officer thinks it's like kids, destroying the graveyard. He realizes it's like people are literally coming out of the graves. So he takes them back to the police station, and they get cleaned up. And one of the people that has come back is his wife, who died 3 years ago of breast cancer. And so then it's kind of, they look normal. They're not like corpses. And then the interesting thing about it is each of the people that come back are from different times. So there's like a girl who died in the 80s. There's a kid who died in the late 1800s. So it's really, really interesting. And they don't, in the beginning, they don't know who they are. And then they start to remember who they are. And then they remember how they died.
Is that Netflix?
And they do flashbacks. It's Netflix. It's a great show. I mean, it's such an interesting, cool show. And then there's some element to it that is, why are they back? You know, should they be back? Right. Because is it breaking some sort of laws of physics or laws of, you know, nature? It's really good.
They did a French series of that about 6 years ago, based on the same thing where, the dead started coming back to this small town in France. That was very good. It has a kind of similar premise. The first season's fantastic. The second season, I can't remember the name off the back of my head at the moment, but that's also available on Netflix, that same story.
Oh, I've got a lot of good stuff out this month.
But I remember that one, because that's the one where wasn't one of the people that comes back was, she was like murdered. She was murdered in some like alley or something, and she comes back and she finds the person who killed her. Is that the same one?
And then you had like the little girl, they had the whole school bus of children that would go, that fall off the bridge. And then the first season's fantastic. Second season, you're like, what the? Because I think, you know, I think they wrote themselves into a hole. So it was like really good. Then the second season, you're going, they're trying to explain everything and it doesn't.
It's called The Returned, I think, right?
That's it. The Returned. That was it.
Yeah. Cool. I tried watching the second season. I got really confused. I was like, I don't understand what's going on. The other one is that I tried watching the second season, but I feel like I have to rewatch the first season. It's called Dark.
Yeah.
That one is super confusing.
It was really, the first season was confusing. Well, the first season was confusing, but the second season was confusing. So the first season's like you're kind of getting into it and you're kind of trying to figure it out. And I do agree with you, but it is confusing. But it kind of worked a little bit because it kind of like left things. But then when the second season came, it got even more confusing. So I couldn't watch the second season. It kind of was like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like 13 Reasons Why. And another thing, I was given a book to read, which the only reason I'm mentioning this for a review, because it kind of fits in what we cover here at the podcast. It's called The Remaking by Clay Chapman. And the reason why I'm bringing this up is inspired by a true story. It's a supernatural thriller for fans of horror and true crime. And it follows a tale as it evolves over every 20 years with terrifying results. Basically, back in the 30s, and this is a true ghost story, basically.
Really?
Ella Louise and her daughter are burned in the small town called Pilot's Creek. And burned at the stake because they thought she was a witch. And then what they did, they buried the mother out where the house was in the woods, and where the woods grows, there's nothing that will grow there in the middle of these woods. It's like a blank circle. And they took the daughter, and they didn't want her to come back from the dead, so they put her all these crosses around her in this graveyard. Then in the 70s, then it jumps to the 70s, where there's this film being made about the story. And what happens is that ends in dire consequences. And then it skips ahead for another 20 years, and they're making a remake of the original movie. And then then it jumps another 20 years up until today, where you got a podcaster trying to figure out what the real story is.
So is it in print?
It's in print. It's out now. It's called The Remaking by Clay Chapman. So I highly suggest that. My review will be out this week. I would have written it.
Cool. That sounds like something I'd like to read, actually.
I was going to say, I feel like I need something to read right now. That is totally at Mally.
Recreational reading.
If you want some that's why I like
the Roanoke of American Horror Story, because it kind of remakes itself, and every four episodes it reinvents itself, and you're like, wait, what's going on? What just happened?
Yeah.
You had to watch that one close.
Yeah. I mean, there's some really good books out there at the moment. So, you know, for our listeners out there who really like books, I do a lot of reviews, but there is one book that you should definitely read. It's called Kill Creek by Scott Thomas. Scott Thomas is the new face of horror. He's pretty much taken Stephen King and Joe Hill and run with it, and with fantastic results. So much so that his first book, which came out last year called Kill Creek, is now being turned into a TV series for Showtime.
All right.
Ooh, nice.
But he's fantastic. I just read his new one as well, and that's excellent as well. So if you're ever looking for some good horror books, just go on to our website at lopodcast.com, go under book reviews, and you'll see all the books that we've been reviewing.
There's a ton of them. Keith's just an animal when it comes to book reviews.
I read about 2 to 3 books a week to review. So it's quite good. Though I did read a book about Keanu Reeves this week when I was ill. So that was interesting.
Like a biography?
kind of like an essay about how great Keanu Reeves is and how sexy he is, it was fun.
He does a lot of really good philanthropical. I can't say it. He's a philanthropist and he does a lot of good
philanthropic, right? Philanthropic.
Yeah, that's the one I was trying to spit out. I couldn't do it. Don't know why.
And I can't, you know, just to jump on the Keanu Reeves really quickly before we go into Last House on Left. I mean, it is quite interesting because for the looks and his acting ability, which sometimes is great, sometimes it's weakens, like we saw in Dracula when we covered that earlier. But I have to sit there and say, I have to admire him because he always picks films that are so off guard for anyone. Any person that is a movie star like him normally goes the safe route, but he's never taken the safe route in anything he's chosen.
No.
Which I my hands go off to him a little bit. Though I still can't figure out John Wick's films. I keep trying them and I keep
being bored, I can't either. Yeah, you're not alone.
So that brings us to The Last House on the Left, the 1972 film by Wes Craven. It's an American exploitation horror film that was written, edited, and directed by Wes Craven and was produced by Sean S. Cunningham of Friday the 13th fans. This film stars Sandra Peabody, Lucy Grantham, David A. Hess, Fred Lincoln, Jeremy Rain, and Mark Scheffler. The plot revolves around two teenage girls who are taken into the woods and tortured by a gang of murderous thugs. The story is inspired by the Swedish film The Virgin Spring of 1960, which was directed by Ingmar Bergman and is considered one of the greatest
films
of that time, which in turn is based on a Swedish ballad, which I'm not going to pronounce that name because I'm going to
Torres got trar I wing.
I wing.
Now, just give you a little bit about The Virgin Springs a little bit before we go back. The Virgin Springs was a foreign film that went far and beyond the 1960s and films of that time. It was a black and white film. It was a Swedish rape and revenge film. And of course, it was directed by Ingmar Bergman, who wrote who wrote and directed The Seventh Seal, and is known as one of the greatest foreign film directors of any time. And no one's ever been able to top him as far as having that category. It was set in medieval Sweden. It was a tale about a father's merciless response to the rape and murder of his young daughter. And they used a 13-year-old girl who gets thrown rape, and it's quite graphic for his time.
Oh, period. Really?
So basically, what we got here is Last House on the Left. We have kind of the guerrilla kind of filmmaking of this story, right, done in an American setting in 1972. Now, the funny thing about it, which I've always thought, this is my view of foreign films against English language films, that in 1960 it was considered art. Do it in an American version, even if you do it frame for frame, it's considered kind of trash a little bit, kind of like, right, uncomfortable, yeah, and stuff like this, which is kind
and
of weird.
Banned.
It's a bit like, for instance, like you'll see French and they'll have like intercourse sex. And because they're speaking French, it's fine, this is art. But if they were to talk in English, it'd be just porn. It's kind of like that.
Basically.
Another interesting thing about Last House on the Left is the directorial debut of Wes Craven. Now, this isn't the first thing he's ever done. He was making commercials and stuff like this, and he decided to cash in on the drive-in phase and make a movie. And this movie cost $87,000 to make, and it was filmed in New York City and rural Connecticut in 1971. It was released theatrically in the United States on August 30th, 1972, and was a major box office success, grossing over $3 million domestically, although its confrontational violence resulted in being heavily censored and sometimes banned in other countries. The film was generally well-received by critics. The film also was remade in the same title in 2009. Personally, I kind of prefer, I find the 2009 one a bit easier to watch, because when we get into the film, I'll tell you what problems I have with this film. But what's quite interesting is that we do have the guerrilla documentary style that would actually become quite fanciful back in the late 80s, early 90s with Blair Witch and using that document film style. And it also does give a nod to the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which has the same kind of film.
Right. Film style. Yeah, definitely, yeah, did do that. Mm-hmm.
I think that we also had to give our eye, if it wasn't for Last House on the Left, we wouldn't have Wes Craven, and we wouldn't have Sean S. Cunningham, we wouldn't have Friday the 13th. Sean S. Cunningham is the producer, the director of Friday the 13th, and owns the rights of that, so much so that he's passed it down to his family, who now are carrying on that name. So, and Vicky, anything you want to add about the making of Last House on the Left?
Well, they're basically, the actors were all unknowns, except for one, I believe. What was it? Was it Scheffler was into doing porn? Was it him?
Yeah, Mark Scheffler was a porn actor.
Yeah, and what I found interesting was that Hess was really kind of beaten up on Peabody, who played the primary victim in the movie. And during the rape scene, I guess he was being a little more vigilant, and she really couldn't do too much about it. But I found it, I apparently he threatened to throw her off a cliff if she didn't get her cues the first time or whatever. He was just kind of a hostile person to work with. And I was like reading this, and I guess Wes Craven throughout the movie was giving her, comfort. Can you imagine doing that in a film set these days, with the Me Too movement and everything else? But I mean, it kind of put a little more into the film considering this was going on, because he was staying in. He's a method actor, I guess, is what you would call him. Mm-hmm. But they were unknown or they were doing soap operas and whatnot, but they all kind of bonded, I guess, on set because they were unknowns. And so, you know,
well, that's quite interesting is the woman who's playing Sadie, Jermaine Rain, at this time was doing a show off Broadway and she's playing Susan Atkins of the Charles Manson murders, which is quite interesting.
Oh, wow.
She's the first person I thought of when I saw her in this movie. So, God, she reminds me of Sadie from the Manson murders. And then when I started reading about the film, it's like, oh, man, I can see why, because her chemistry would be perfect for a role like that. Just would be.
I mean, what about you, John? Do you have anything about the making of it?
I just found it interesting. You talk about method acting. I found it interesting that Grantham recalled that during the scene in which she had to pee her pants, she actually did.
Pee her pants, so
She went the whole way there for that one.
Yep, she did.
And cut scene.
That would be kind of hard for me to sit there and piss my pants in front of everybody. But hey, you know, it works.
All for the art.
So
what we're going to do is we're going to cut to a commercial break in the trailer for Last House on the Left and be right back after a word from our sponsors.
We are one planet. We share one extraordinary home. We are millions of wonders, but we are all one world. If we only get one chance to save our planet, to protect it for the next generation, then we have to take it. This is our chance. This is our fight. For our planet, for our home, for all of us. Join WWF today.
It rests on 13 acres of earth over the very center of hell. Here is the first motion picture to offer to the daring a look into the final, maddening space between life and death. The Last House on the Left. To avoid fainting, keep repeating.
It's only a movie. Only a movie. Only a movie.
Sights and sounds far beyond anything you've tested. The Last House on the Left. To avoid fainting, keep repeating.
It's only a movie. Only a movie. Only a movie.
Take as only much as you can.
Only a movie.
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast, and we're discussing The Last House on the Left, the 1972 film. So, Vicky, what are your thoughts about The Last House on the Left?
Well, I thought it was a little all over the place, kind of, though. And it was they had their humorous moments, like with the police and everything else. I had to really watch it or I wasn't going to follow it very well. I don't know. I had a hard time with this. I didn't dislike it, but I had a hard time with this movie. Maybe because it was a little all over the place. And maybe because I believe some of the actors just weren't prepared to have to deal with the hardcore of the movie that they had to embrace. So you could tell some of them were totally noobs. But I mean, you get vested in the characters, especially the parents, I would say, throughout the whole movie. Because it's like, if that was my daughter, I would have done far worse. But
far worse than biting a person's penis?
Well, yeah, I mean, I would have had, yeah, true. I mean, yeah, that's true. She did bite his penis off, didn't she?
I mean, for me, about the film, there's a lot I like about this film. And there's only one thing about this film that it could be one of the most fantastic films of the 70s, exploitation horror films that are coming out at this time that ruins it. It's the cop sequences. I think if you get to get rid of the cops and the hillbilly music that's playing, it would have been fantastic.
I kept thinking of, do you remember BJ and his best friend Bear?
Yeah, BJ and the Bear.
I kept thinking of that. And I was like, okay, why are we going into these like Benny Hill moments? Like where it's supposed to be like, to me, more serious, right? But when they would go into those moments, it'd be like, let's get into a car. You know, I'm like, what the hell?
Let's get in a truck full of chickens.
Oh, I mean, I know. That
she's like,
oh, she
I have to sit there
really
and say, do I have to say that the hippie that's taunting the deputy in one of the scenes is someone that you should know? His name is Steve Miner. Steve Miner is the director of Halloween 2 and the director of Friday 13th Part 2 and Part 3.
So we had a bunch of people come out of this joining of talent. Yeah.
Well, basically, they set the marks of horror onto what we know today. So that's quite interesting.
Well, yeah,
that's
they so are funny. They are the biggest and the best, for sure. But you're right. That maybe that's what was bothering me about the movie, because it was kind of serious. I like my slasher flicks, you know that. But I really didn't see any need for the police scenes. I mean, there had to be a reason why he put them in there. I know he wanted some lighter humor involved mm-hmm. and make the cops look stupid. I get that. But it was kind of a distraction from what was actually supposed to be going on in the movie.
Well, I guess, I mean, we will be covering Texas Chainsaw Massacre later on in season 3. But it'd be like if they took Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which is the first film, and, you know, I'm not going to get into it now, but the guy in the wheelchair.
But put funny cops in there.
Fucking, yeah. And put some comedy sequences like in the middle of it. And what makes Texas Chainsaw Massacre work is the tenseness of it. You're just so tense in your own
yeah.
your seat.
Yeah.
Like, what's going to happen?
Well,
Outside of Franklin.
Was missing in this. I felt like there wasn't that tension in this that I was expecting. I was expecting there to be, like, a buildup, especially when they come into the place. They think they're buying weed, and they get locked into a place. Like, I felt like that's where the tension should start to build, and it didn't feel that way.
I mean, that's why
the actress that played Sadie, what was her name again?
Jane Rain.
She was actually very good at playing
Jeremy
a psycho.
Rain. She was very good. I mean, I have to say that the psychos were really horrendous. I mean, horrendous in the fact that they kind of made your skin crawl. Very good.
Oh, God,
about their,
yeah.
Very good. But they kind of set you on edge. And even the young boy who looked like, you know, basically looked like the form of incest or whatever he was, but
Junior Cillo.
Yeah, but he didn't set you on edge and stuff like this. But then it's kind of weird because the film does do this thing that's quite interesting. That basically you get them the way that they torture these girls, and the thing is that there are four versions of this film that you can see. So it all depends what version you have. I got the Blu-ray, so I have all four versions, and there a lot of the violence has been sliced here and there. I mean, this film is still banned in quite a few countries today.
Yeah. Well, I could see, you know, you got forced female on female rape, you know, which was probably something really like new for people. So,
but what I also found quite interesting is that then when they could show up at the parents' house, and then you do get some slight, you find yourself uncomfortable with the slight that you do have a little empathy for some of the killers, like the young boy. You kind of, it's like at first you think, oh, he's a bit freaky, I don't really like him, but you do feel kind of empathy that he's kind of trapped in this situation that,
well,
you know, basically
father.
Well, yeah, but basically yeah. But the thing is yeah, it's because of his father, but the thing is you're born into this. You're never going to get out of it. He's a prisoner. He's a prisoner just as much as those two girls
and
are.
He was in serious need of a dentist.
Well, he was an addict.
Yeah, he was a heroin addict. Yeah.
So it's almost like his father and his father's girlfriend are keeping him on heroin so that way he'll never leave as well. So he's basically in his own prison. And I thought I think that's probably where the film works. Kind of, I think that's where the uncomfortability actually sets in. There's the uncomfortability of them catching the girls and the situation they find themselves in, the driving out there, then what happens by the pond, and then you have what's happened when they show up at the house, and then you have this whole situation. And I think that's where the film is fantastic, and I think this is probably the reason why this is considered a classic, is because of those sequences.
I think I got uncomfortable because of the bad decision making. Like in real life, you don't let a bunch of people come in and stay in your house and make them spaghetti and toss them a salad. Or if I was going to buy drugs, I'm not going to go in somebody's house and let them shut the door.
Yeah, but you got to remember, though, that this is 1972. This is the time where, you know, Ted Bundy was getting all his female victims from hitchhiking, and people were still hitchhiking. You know, you got in cars with strangers at this time. If people showed up at your door, you know, chances are you'd let them come in and use your phone. This is what you did then. You know,
it's funny because when I was rewatching Friday the 13th Part 2, at the beginning, she locks her door, and I laugh because like that's such a like right. a habit. When I get home, my door is locked. I don't right. leave my door open, but I think back then people slept with their doors unlocked. They're just like, no one's going to come and, you know, into my place.
That is true. Back in the day, you know, where we grew up, we used to leave our door open. When I go home to visit now, because of the stuff that's infiltrated into my hometown, you never leave your door open anymore.
Well, yeah. I have to say, yeah. I don't think locking your door became such a general thing that everyone did it until like probably like the mid 80s onwards, and that's when people started doing it. That's when everyone started doing it automatically. But up until that point, I mean, yeah, you used to keep your door unlocked, just like, you know, who's gonna get me? I'm safe. I'm usually on my four walls,
right?
You know, I think as far as that happening, I would say there's a looking at it from a millennial point of view, millennial meaning 2019, not the children or anything like that, but looking at it from a 2019 point of view and looking at it, it does it like, but I think at this time period, I think the cinema goers are actually watching it thinking, this is plausible. I have to sit there and say, when I first saw Last House on the Left, I was in Tulsa. I was at university at the time, and I took a date, and we went to a midnight movie, and it was a double feature between this and Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Perfect.
And I just sit there and say that when we finished watching these two movies, and I have to sit there and say, when I saw this in the theater, this had a totally different approach than what I've seen on the home video since that time. And this film, it used to haunt me. But I think it's when you see it in a cinema and the lights are dark and it's like nothing else around you and there's nothing to take your mind off anything, it's a pretty grueling film. And I remember, I'm quite good with grueling films and stuff like this. But in 1983, there wasn't a lot of films like this. But this was like something new for me. I mean, of course, now we've seen tons of films like this. And I remember the person I was named, his name was Chris, and he was shell-shocked. To the point that we went to IHOP afterwards, because it was a midnight movie, we saw these two movies back to back with not a break in between, and we went to IHOP afterwards, and he was like shaking to the simple fact that, you know, he couldn't even order his pancakes or eat his pancakes. And I had to then say, and I said that I came out of the cinema watching these two films, and I was totally shaken by both of them. And we saw Texas Chainsaw Massacre first, and this is the second feature.
Well, that was definitely a disturbing movie, even to this day. Yeah. The original Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
I find that more disturbing than this, because I think that just was, you felt no hope, right? You just felt no hope for the people that were getting picked off one by one.
Yeah.
With them, I still felt like, you know, with this movie, I felt that at least the hope was the parents, because then once they kind of find out, which I'm still not a big believer in, like, okay, so you find out by seeing him wearing the necklace that it's your daughter's necklace.
And then she overhears the conversation.
She overhears the conversation, but then they find her that quickly. they found her rather quick. I was like, how? Come on. No.
I mean, didn't she, now, the thing is, I had to sit there and say, looking at it now and reassessing it, I think at the time period, I think, you know, I said before, I think, you know, if I went to the movie theaters and that's the time, I don't have the film history that I have now. And I said, this film really kind of fucked me over when I first saw it, because I didn't have the full flush of every, I mean, I've seen a lot now. I've seen so many horror films that gore and violence and stuff like this, I'm quite immune to it. I mean, I got to a point where even I'm so immune to it that if I saw someone getting stabbed in real life, I'd probably just walk by and go, I'm on my way to work.
So desensitized have we become.
But I have to say that there's things that this film does that Texas Chainsaw Massacre doesn't do. And this actually does show you the violence. Texas Chainsaw Massacre is actually quite, you don't see any of the blood, you don't see any of the gore, you don't see anything. And I know that in your mind, you think that you have seen all this thing, but when we go back and we'll be revisiting Texas Chainsaw Massacre, you don't really see anything. You don't see any knives going into people's bodies and stuff like this. This one, you actually do see the insertion of weapons going in.
Yeah.
And I think that's probably why Last House on the Left has probably stood the pinnacle of its time. I'm not saying they're saying that Texas Chainsaw Massacre is a better film, but I'm sitting there saying that I think that the reason why this one probably also stands up there next to it or slightly below it has to be because you are actually seeing violence in this kind of graphic detail for the first time.
Rape is always disturbing, especially, you know, I think for anybody with half a brain, that's disturbing.
But another thing is, though, you do see the knife kind of enter her. When he's stabbing, you're kind of seeing the knife go into her. You didn't see this before in cinema. And then when you look at, you know, the chainsaw sequence at the end with the chainsaw fight, even though it looks a bit radical, you know, kind of looks a bit not as polished as what we're used to, but at the time, this is to say, you haven't, take all the film history that you've seen and all the films that you've seen up to this point and just erase all that history, and you're watching this for the first time. And so I can imagine that it must have been like, what the fuck is going on?
I know.
You know, it's a bit like, you know, like first time I saw Friday the 13th, the first Friday the 13th, and, you know, and you're just watching the throat go across, you know, the knife going across the throat.
Oh, man, the eyeballs. The arrow to the eyeball. That one, I still grimace. I don't do eyeballs.
But what about the first time you saw a knife go across the throat and the throat opens up and all the
blood comes still out? Bothers me.
You know, I mean, now it's kind of like you're a little bit desensitized to it. So, but the first time
it's all CGI'd. It's all, you know,
it's just a movie. Didn't they advertise it's just a movie because people were upset over, you know, everything that was going on in it?
The simple fact is that people thought that because of the film style of this film when it came out, and David A. Hess had a problem after this film came out, because people actually thought that he was Krueger. They thought he was a murderer. They thought that this was actual crime that was filmed.
Well, he did his job well. He was a real butt through the whole movie. You had to hate him. He was a disgusting, loathsome human being, his character was. And so it's sort of like, you know, I can see where he'd be accosted walking down the street after this movie came out. They did. They, to avoid fainting, they had to keep repeating it's only a movie because people were visibly shaken when they were watching it. So you're probably right. It was probably the first time where people actually saw, you know, people getting stabbed. I mean, the girl in the when they got her in the graveyard, you know, I mean, that was a real ass beating. It just was. Yeah. It was disturbing.
I mean, it does have some really disturbing images in it, and it does work on that. And I do think for its time period, I would sit there and say that, let's face it. I mean, the United States, it was banned in quite a few states. United Kingdom, it was banned up until probably 10 years ago. Australia is still pretty much banned. You can't get an uncut version of it. But then again, there's also the infamy behind it as well. So, you know.
I think one of the most disturbing scenes is when she's walking into the water.
Yeah.
Mari. And then he, you know, he shoots her, and then it goes, the camera goes away, and it's in the yard of someone's yard, and the dogs hears the sound of the gun, and then you hear the gun again and again. So it's like that, like you're not seeing what's happening, but you know what's happening. Yeah. It's that was really disturbing to me. I was like, ooh.
It does state, though, in the research that the movie was, like, hacked to pieces, and there were copies that were cut and sold because they took out the lesbian rape scene, apparently. They took out where Mari's in her room going through her birthday cards nude, and Mari being raped by Sadie. They took that out because I can't imagine people even seeing that in regular film these days. I've not seen any of those special deleted scenes or whatnot.
Yeah, I haven't either. Yeah.
Disturbing.
But in one of these cuts that's on this, because I sat through two of the cuts. I've seen the film quite a few times now, so right. I've seen all four versions. But in one version of the film, which is called Krug and Company, which is what one of the original titles for the film before it got changed, basically Mari is alive, and that's how the parents find out that they come and she comes in and she's all raped and she's dying and she's bleeding everywhere, and they put her on the sofa, and then they. That's when they start putting everything together. Apparently, they thought that when it was being released, that was one of the problems that people had a problem with, is actually seeing this person bleeding and raped and butchered and still alive.
Yeah,
and
right.
The parents, I think it had more to do with how do parents react to this. You're trying, it's your job to protect your daughter, and you let your daughter go out and borrow your car, and this is what happens, so you didn't do your job. So there's that whole thing probably tying into
Wes Craven edited this movie, so apparently was he pressured into editing this movie to you know, like this, or was it his personal decision, or you know?
Well, the thing is an interesting thing about this film as well, and this goes along with Night of the Living Dead's another kind of film that's kind of it's going to fit this bill. Texas Chainsaw Massacre is another film that they weren't distributed by big major movie companies.
Right.
So basically what would happen is that they would do the prints themselves, and then they would give them out, and they would go out to different drive-ins or backstage cinemas, backlot cinemas. And then what they'll do is that the owner would look at them, and then they would cut it to the way they wanted it to be shown. So then basically what happens is that a lot of these films, that's the reason why a lot of like these 70s films and stuff like this, you have this thing like, you know, oh, I would like to see a director's cut because no one's actually seen the original cut of everything.
Yeah.
So we were probably fortunate at the time that this film could have been lost, but because the horror fans kept the spirit of this film alive, and Wes Craven was alive, he was able to go back in and give you like the real version of it.
Right.
Where like, that's probably the reason why. And you kind of, I guess you get this in Grindhouse. If you ever saw Grindhouse, the Tarantino and Rodriguez film that they did, it was kind of a nod to Grindhouse. And what you have is you would have missing scenes, like in that. That's what you would see at the cinema. It's like all of a sudden you get this weird jump cut and you're in a different place altogether.
Right.
So,
That makes sense because the version that I watched, I was wondering there was some weird editing going on, and I was like, "What just happened?" And I was like, I had a House of Dark Shadows moment. I was like, "What the hell? Yeah. Where am I? What just happened?"
Yeah. So what you give it a lot of these films, and then when they resurface, is that sometimes the only negative that they will have, or the only film they will have, is something that's already been cut, and that's been cut by not the people who made the film. And so that's why sometimes you get these weird cuts in these weird 70s films, is that there's probably something in there that probably shouldn't have been. I mean, good thing that we got with Last House on the Left is that, you know, with the Blu-ray, and there's two great companies. If you're buying Blu-ray disc and you're interested in buying older films, always buy from Screen Factory or Arrow for your Blu-rays, because they really go back in and they actually put everything back together the way it's meant to be seen, the way it should be seen, and they colorize and they spend a lot of money on it. And to be honest, it's quite surprising that the Blu-rays don't cost more than what they do. So,
right.
But you know, but it's one of those. I mean, probably the only thing that, and I have to sit there and say that it's probably more or less the violence, you know. And it is pretty graphic for its time period, you know. And I can just imagine.
It's interesting because the ending that they chose wasn't like, because the remake, it actually, she does survive, and that's how the parents find out. And I felt like it was, that ending was a better ending.
Yeah. I had something to say. I actually like the remake a bit better than this.
I agree.
I find that weird. Only because it's a bit more coherent. The cops are missing.
Thank God.
Yeah.
I think I would love to, I wish there was a way that they could, the home video version of this, that you could find a way that you could make your own version of it by cutting out the cops and watching the film without the cops in it, because I think it would be a better experience.
I was trying to put my finger on it, but that's truly that the cop sequence was really unnecessary. At least I thought so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, you know, what's quite interesting is John Sacco, a British film activist, recalled discussing the film with American theater owners. And he's quotes, "Projectionists were so offended, they would just cut up the film so they were watching it. I asked people, how cut is your version? They say, it's not as cut as some of the others I've seen. That's hardly what you want to hear." So it would also depend on what cinema you want to see and what version you saw. Every time you want to see this movie at a different cinema, you see a different version of it, because people were just cutting it the way they wanted to cut it. So it's amazing this film actually survived the way it has.
Well, you can tell, though, when you're watching I watched it on Amazon, but you could tell there's stuff missing.
Yeah.
Because some of it doesn't make sense.
Well, to me, it was like, I was like, oh, it's not that violent. And then when I was reading or doing, looking to notes at Wikipedia and stuff, I was reading how graphic it was and how it was edited, and I was like, oh, that makes sense, because I'm like, it's not that graphic, and now that makes sense why, because they cut a lot of that out.
I do kind of wonder, is this, I don't know, maybe you can, someone's done some more research than what I have in front of me, but wasn't a church group fund this film?
Oh, no, I didn't know that, no.
Yeah, I think they got the money, I think they got the money from a church group.
Really?
Oh, wow.
I didn't see that in any research at all.
I think I have it. I think there's on the documentary, I think Wes Craven, God bless his soul, states that I think they got the money from a church group because they were like trying to invest in a movie sort of thing and they wanted something that was about good versus evil.
Well, it also, by the way, it does speak to if they did create that movie for that purpose, because it's trying to put the fear of God in kids, you know, like, so the, you know, because it does, like, the mom's talking to the daughter and she's like, with the bra, not wearing a bra, you know, well, why are you not wearing a bra? You know, like things like that. It could be, well, this is what happens when you don't sort of follow the laws or the rules of things, right? You're going to get attacked. You're going to, it's like Reefer Madness. Remember, you know, the madness behind something. It's like, let's put the fear inside in, you know. So it'd be interesting if that's why.
Well, the Christian Science Monitor, their new service, referred to the film as desperately sordid melodrama and vulgarized the version of The Virgin Spring and drew comparisons to Sam Peckinpah's Straw Dogs.
Mm. I mean, Straw Dogs, I mean, the thing is, that's another film that, you know, you watch it today and you're like, what's the big deal? But at the time, I mean, that's another film that was quite, you know, the rape of Susanna York in that.
Right.
And you kind of watch it now. I mean, you know, I've seen I Spit on Your Grave, which you mentioned earlier, the original. And that was quite horrific for his time period. And it's still very uncomfortable. I mean,
it's very remakes, uncomfortable.
And the remakes even are the, even the remakes ones, are worse. So
even the other ones that you watch, and you can see a nod here and there to other movies up with I Spit on Your Grave that they took from some of these movies. Mm-hmm. You could tell where they went with that. But those were really uncomfortable. And I just jam-fested all of them, you know, this week. It's like, well, seeing as we're doing all these other movies, I'm going to watch these. And they were hard to watch. I don't know if it's because I'm a woman or whatever, but, you know, rape scenes.
But
brutal.
even the original, the 1974 I Spit on Your Grave, the original one that stars Buster Keaton's daughter, Camille Keaton, the one that's, you know, springs it up, that's very uncomfortable, the rape in that. And then you see the one in Straw Dogs, and this is the one that, basically, you know, Straw Dogs was banned up until recently in a lot of countries. And that stars, you know, this is, but I think this also is that I Spit in Your Grave was an independent film like this and like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, where Straw Dogs was a major studio film. And maybe that's probably the reason why. Because I have to say, when I did see Straw Dogs, I do have a copy of it, and it's a very, very good film. But when you see the rape sequence in that, you're kind of like left a bit cold. Not like you see like in this film or I Spit on Your Grave or some of the other ones where you're like, oh, I mean, it's heart-wrenching. And, you know, we'll get to another rape scene in our next film. But
I know, yeah. Keith, it's not me picking all the rape movies, people. It's Keith.
No, it was John Wilson, actually.
It was John Wilson.
I'm the sadistic one here. And I actually, the funny thing was, is I actually picked Big Driver first, and I was like, well, I remember the Last House on the Left, the remake, and going, oh, that would be a good one. But I'm like, let's go do the original, because I had never seen the original.
Right.
So I think my first thought was Big Driver, because I just remember being totally just like, oh, my God. In the book, it's even more painful.
That was on Lifetime. Lifetime. I'm sorry, Hallmark. They would never put something like that on there. But it was. I just happened to come across that movie, and I was like, "What the fuck is this?" I know we're gonna get into it later, but I'm going, "Holy shit, this is brutal for Lifetime."
I'm the sadistic one. I'm the one who picked the rape scene. Sorry, folks.
It was all John. Okay, so Keith gets a hard pass.
He gets a reprieve.
I got a reprieve on this one. So I guess, is there anything you want to add about Last House on the Left, Vicky, and your final thoughts?
Well, you know, after talking with you guys, I realized why I was having a hard time with it, and I probably ought to watch the director's cut, because it wasn't making any sense, and you're right about the police. Totally stupid having them in there. Don't know why. I don't know why there was comedy relief, because it was really a good slasher horror flick. you know, that could have been more promising had they just deleted those scenes. So I'll watch the 2009 version. But I mean, it's Wes Craven. So, I mean, it is a must-see because Wes Craven's always been a brilliant director as far as I'm concerned. And I would watch it. I mean, it's a cult classic, so we're all about those. And I would give it a major thumbs up for people out there that haven't seen it.
And what about yourself, John? What are your final thoughts of The Last House on the Left?
I actually am glad I watched it. I want to actually now find an unedited, because I feel like it will maybe change some of the elements for, or maybe right. Like Keith said, the edited sheriffs out of it. Maybe I find that version, because again, it felt a little Dukes of Hazzard at times to me.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it was disturbing. There's elements in there that you can't not like walk away from this film being like, wow, that, you know, they got justice and they get revenge. Yeah. But at the same time, I felt still like dead. Cause I mean, the fact that she died, you know, they both died. It's just leaves you like, there's no winners here. They got revenge. They got to, you know, enact their revenge on this, but it's still sad. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, with myself, I recognize the film as being one of the greats in the horrors of, you know, the annals of horror films. I think it's it was a precursor to a lot of things that we would get later on.
Definitely not.
I do think that there's a lot of I do like about it. I do like the tenseness of the situations that the characters are in. It does feel like, you know, there are moments in this film that it does feel like these things are actually happening to these people, and there's some sadistic filmmaker just filming this crime going on, and you do have some of that. But then there are times that it does feel like they're acting. So it's kind of a torn situation for me. I recognize it for what it is. And I said before, when I first saw it the first time, I was like, what the fuck? Sort of thing, basically. And I was like, I was quite shocked by it. Looking at it now, I'm not as shocked by it as it is, but I do recognize that without Last House on the Left, we wouldn't have Friday the 13th, we wouldn't have Wes Craven, and we probably wouldn't have Steve Miner either.
Because people who, for the Literary License podcast, are desensitized human beings, and we try to outgrow each other.
Yep.
But saying that, I do think that, you know, it demands, if you are a fan of horror, I think, and horror films are your thing and it is your go-to, and I think that you do need to have a rich understanding of everything horror. And I think that it's one film that you probably do need to see at least once if you're a fan of horror. If you're not a fan of horror, I don't think this is going to turn you on to horror films.
No.
But if you are interested in the history of horror, I think, you know, like this, and there are other films like this as well, whether you're dealing with, you know, bug monsters from the 50s or Psycho or upwards and onwards into what we have today, that, you know, this film is very, very important in that kind of essence. But I think that if you're hoping to get that feeling of being on your edge, kind of very unsettled, and to the point where you can't watch anymore, and you have been desensitized by everything that you've seen, and up, you know, even watching the news, this film probably is not going to have that unsettling vision that the original cinema goers would have had at the time. But I do appreciate it for what it is. And I fucking hate the cops. I'm sorry. I can't stand them.
They really didn't have any place in the movie. I don't understand why they were there, but
I think that the cops weren't there, they probably would have got a hard X.
Yeah.
And maybe putting the cops in there was probably the reason why they got an R.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, you also kind of need it at the end, because they're trying to stop the parents from like finishing the job, if you will, because, like, you know, that he was the last one left. I, by the way, I also still, like, I agree with you, Keith. I feel bad for Junior. I mean, he was like, just kill yourself. Go ahead, kill yourself. You know, it's like, poor kid. And
well,
he's like, okay.
For everybody that's for the, you know, the Me Tooers out there or whatever, the mother does bite off the guy's penis. So there is redemption.
Well, I do think, but I do think that this film, and I think this is probably where it does get its nod towards the Swedish original that this is based on, is that basically it's about being caught in your own prisons, and everyone's caught in their own prison, whether you're the victims or the girls are caught in their prison, they're in a prison, they're not being so naive, find themselves in a situation. Then they're in the prison of, in the way of the cops. The parents are in a prison because they got this thing that you're supposed to protect your children, which they didn't. They weren't able to the point, you know, because they're going to have that, you know, even after this is over with, you can know that they're going to be stuck in this prison of that, oh my God, why did we let her go? Why did we let her go to the big city and all this other stuff? And
then I know.
And then you have the criminals stuck in their own prison. You got Crew, who's, you know, probably a product of the prison system, or imagine. You got the son who's, you know, a prisoner in his own world and his own addictions. And then you got even the female who, you know, the lesbian, bisexual, whatever she is. I mean, she's a prisoner of her environment as well. So I guess if Wes Craven is, if you're going to look for something of like a deep meaning, if you want to put a deep meaning onto this, I guess it is a film about everyone being a prisoner of who they are and what their circumstances are in their lives. So, because no one breaks away from that.
Yeah.
It was a good movie, though. I mean, I would watch it. I mean, especially if you like anything that's Wes Craven. And like you said, I did notice in a lot of the movies I was watching the last few days, because like I said, I binge watch when I get going. And there's a lot of different nods towards this movie and several others. So
what we're going to do is we're going to move over to John, because John's going to take over co-hosting, because he's going to deal with Big Driver, because this was his big choice.
It was his rape movie. John's second rape movie choice.
Sorry, folks. It's going to get a little bit more brutal. So I picked Big Driver. Actually, Stephen King's book, Full Dark, No Stars, if you've not read it, it's a 4 or 5 different short stories, right, that have been made into other movies. So 1922, which is on Netflix, Big Driver. Fair Extension has a Good Marriage has. So A Good Marriage was fantastic as well. I picked it because, like, I'm just a huge Stephen King fan. B, he sort of, I like how his sort of his afterwards in his book, it says, "The stories in this book are harsh. You may have found them hard to read in places. If so, be assured that I found them equally as hard to write in places." So he definitely goes there, specifically in this story. I feel like reading it is very different from watching the experience of what happens, because it's sort of a gradual build. And then when the main character is actually being raped, there's just this moment where you kind of hope she doesn't survive. You know, there's a moment where you just go, guy, you know, this is brutal. It's very brutal. But then when she does, you can't help but say, I hope she fucking gets revenge. I hope she goes after this person. Oh my God.
But you know, she's such a little woman too. I mean, and these men are like giants, you know, just like, it's bad enough to be raped, but to be raped by a 7-foot-tall man, no.
Yeah, and I love Maria Bello. She's just fantastic as
I love her. Yes, and she's great in this movie.
I love Olympia Dukakis. I mean, she is just there's a brilliance to the film and the story that I know for myself, as I'm writing stories, I see these characters in my head and I see what they are, and sometimes they talk to me and sometimes I respond to them. But I love seeing how it's visualized. And in the book, it's very different because it is all in her head and she's thinking about what she needs to do. Like, how do I need to survive this situation? Mm-hmm. And with this, it's kind of interesting to see how it's manifested, and it's manifested in one of her main characters, Dorian, who is part of the Knitting Club crime novels, which I think is fantastic. How she's trying to work through something, and in her mind she's like, okay, how am I going to get through this? And then, you know, she pops out and she's like, well, you know, how do we handle a case of such and such and such and such?
Was the brilliant part of this movie, is how she goes back to her characters that she's written about, and just like how she's going to handle these guys. And so she has the meeting with the old ladies or whatever
in
her head.
Yeah.
About how she's gonna. I loved it. I thought it was fantastic. Yeah.
So what I think we should do is we should cut to a commercial break in the trailer, and then we'll go into a full discussion of Big Driver, the 2014 crime thriller TV film based on the novella by Stephen King.
Mm-hmm. as a writer. You have to understand human nature. Fear. Murder. And revenge.
I think it's time, dear, for friggin' payback.
You really don't belong in a place like this.
Have a safe trip home. You're crazy!
You have to understand human nature.
Hi, I'm Eli Roth.
And I'm underwater cinematographer Joe Romero.
We're here on behalf of our friends at Shark Allies. There's a very important moment happening right now in Florida legislature, and we need your support.
Florida imports and exports more shark fins than any place in the country.
And there's a bill on the table to ban it completely. Shark finning is illegal in the U.S., but the shark fin trade is not. It's only illegal in 12 states.
Florida will be the 13th state out of all 50 to adopt the no shark fin trade policy.
Even though the shark finning is illegal, the trade is actually driving more illegal activity. If we eliminate the trade, we can eliminate finning.
We lose an estimated 100 million sharks a year. It's 11,000 sharks an hour and 3 sharks a second. No animal can keep up with that. That's mass extinction.
Go here and sign this petition and let your voice be heard. And follow our friends at Shark Allies. Whether you are from Florida or not, we need your help.
Let's ban the shark fin trade completely.
So we're back, folks, and we are going to begin the discussion of the film. One of the first things I think I really love about the film is it starts with such a very, very light and warm feeling. You feel, you know, the character of Tess is, you know, an author, and she's someone who's very, you could see, optimistic, lives in a very beautiful home, and is such an open-hearted person. And I think it's her sister or her friend comes to see her, and they're talking with each other, and it just begins with such a lightheartedness. And by the end of the film, it just gets darker and darker throughout the film, which I don't know if like either of you noticed that, but It starts very warm in the beginning, like there's a lot of warm gels, and she's in these really cute little outfits, and she's just some, you know, but by the end of it, it's toughened her, and you can tell that it's something that she's sort of narrating throughout the film in different ways in her head through the GPS, which I love, Tom. So like, I love that throughout the film, that there's different ways that Tess's voice is portrayed throughout the entire film without it actually being her voice. And I love also just like the crime solving aspect of it. Like, you have to come sometimes work your way out of situations. And I'll go, you know, just briefly go back to what Stephen King said in his book. It's like, the people in these stories are not without hope, but they acknowledge that even our fondest hopes and our fondest wishes for our fellow men and society in which we live may sometimes be vain, often even. But I think that also says that nobility most fully resides in not success, but in trying to do the right thing. And that when we fail to do that or willfully turn away from the challenge, hell follows. And so she's, you know, just trying to do her job, and she's an author, and she's going to go and, you know, do a book signing. I think that's why she's there.
And the Library of Congress, didn't she, or something like that?
Yeah, she went to some library, and, you know, she wanted to take a quicker way home, and she got a quicker way home.
Yeah, library. Library. She was in Chicopee, Massachusetts. That's where she went.
Chicopee.
For me, I think there's a lot that works in this film. I do think that probably as a short story, I think it probably works slightly better with the voices inside your head. Though saying that, I love Olympia Dukakis. And I have to sit there and say, I think we really need to take the number one scene stealer in this whole film is Joan Jett.
Yeah.
Why this woman doesn't do more movies is beyond me. She did Light of Day, which it's not a great film, but she's bloody fantastic in this. And she steals this film so well to the point where it's like, you see her and you know, and I say that this film is the actors that they put in this film is cast fantastically well. And I do think that we need to give a shout out to Richard Christen Matheson, whose father is Richard Matheson, who wrote who's pretty much done all the Poe stories that we're covering in our Poe situation and Trilogy of Terror and Twilight Zone and things like this. So it's quite interesting to see the torch being carried on to the next generation with Richard Christen Matheson. There is a TV feeling about this movie that does feel, it does have that network TV. And the only thing that really sets this apart is I find for a TV movie that the rape scene in this is very brutal. It's one of the most brutal rape sequences, which, to be honest, because you do, as you were saying, you have the beginning where you have the kind of fuzzy, warm feeling behind it. And then you do get the rape sequence was like bloody brutal, and then we kind of go back into the TV movie mode a little bit again, sort of thing. And I do wonder that if it was handled by Netflix or someone like that, would we have got that TV movie shine that's over this, because it does have that TV movie gloss over it the way that it's filmed sort of thing.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's also the music, some of the music, the way it's used, it sounds very that's where I think, Vicky, when you said Hallmark, it sounds very Hallmark,
because the
music,
when
she's driving into town and she's like, you know, it's like this music and you're like, that wouldn't be in a normal like Netflix or HBO or anything like that. That music would be much more insidious. It would be, it's setting something up, like, you know, something bad's going to happen in the beginning of it. You don't think anything bad. Like if I had never read the story and I just watched the movie, I would have been like, whoa, what just happened here? Like, yeah. What's going on? You know?
But I have to say that what's quite interesting, though, that this kind of does fit the Stephen King way of doing things.
Yeah.
I mean, there are the Stephen King tropes in this film. You know, it's a writer. She's going to meet her fans, you know, and then something horrible happens to the writer. And then basically you get the redemption story that comes afterwards.
Right.
So you get, if I didn't know this was a Stephen King story, I would, once I watched it, and then once you start putting things together, you could tell that it's a Stephen King story.
Yeah.
And that's not taking away anything at all from Stephen King. I think
it's also part of the survivalism, right? It's like survivalism too. It's a big trope of his.
Did you think that Betsy, that Joan Jett playing the waitress, do you think that she alluded to knowing that they were the two brothers were doing this, and the mother, that she was possibly a victim?
I would say yes, because at the end, especially when she calls her and she's like, she says, "Oh, Betsy," and she goes, "I know you did it. Good for you, girl." And then she hangs up. Mm. So she knew.
Well, I don't know. I don't think that she was a victim of them. I think she's a victim of domestic abuse.
Right.
And I think, as far as, she probably, you know, it is a small town and everyone knows small town business.
Right.
And everyone knows, you know, about the evil people. If you live in a small town, which Vicky and I are from, you know, we do know of evil people that do, and sometimes they do get away with things. We might not know exactly what they've been up to, but we know they've been up to some dodgy dealings or something quite horrible. So there is, you know, there is that sort of thing. I think the only faults I did find with this, I do like this movie a lot, and it kept me entertained. It didn't keep me entertained. I wouldn't say entertained, but it kept me
vested.
Involved. It kept me vested in it and stuff like this. But there are some things that I kind of wondering that I would have liked might have been a bit better, and that probably would be the simple fact that if we had a female director covering this, would have been a different kind of feel to it. There's nothing wrong with the feel of this movie at all, but there, I love Libby Dukakis, and I do think that it's
I love her in this. Circle. I just love anything and I love he
the,
does.
And I do like the tom-tom, and I think it does work. But in a weird way, it kind of takes you out of it in a strange way for a little bit.
Yeah.
And, I don't want to be, there's not being negative. This is just like, if I was going to make the perfect movie, I'm mm-hmm. not sure if I would have included those. And I think that probably, I'm not sure if you read the short story, so you probably can fill this in a bit more, because I haven't, I stopped reading Stephen King quite a while ago now. And that's no fault of Stephen King. That's more too busy reading really thick books for me. So I do think that what might have worked, is this kind of word for word of the short story? Or they made some changes in the short story?
Yes and no. They made some changes to it. And I was actually trying to go back to look, because I want to say that one of the problems that I had, the only one of the problems that I had, is I think when she is at the end, when she has now finished killing the big driver, she hears, Dorian saying, you're forgetting something, you're missing something.
Right.
And I think the thing that she's missing is, and it's the obvious thing, even in the film, is not her cell phone, but the tom-tom.
Right.
Because the tom-tom shows where she's been.
Right.
Yeah.
So something happens where it triggers, and she goes, oh my God. And she realizes that she has to get rid of the history in her tom-tom, because if they check her tom-tom, it shows everywhere that she's went. Mm. So that was like a bigger, to me, like, oh, that's so smart. I was like, what? That's so smart,
Mm. See, I found that with the, the imaginary characters are now living and breathing in her head, I guess. And to be honest, this is where I found some slight confusion. If I was gonna go into the film, and this is what we're doing, is, if I was just watching this film, most of this stuff would have passed me by, and I would be quite happy with the film. But when she pulls out, there's a couple things that didn't quite make sense. So when she pulls out, and then basically you see the women's knitting circle, her characters in the book in the window. And then she goes to town, and then, and then she goes, does her book signing. And then this is where I think and this is nothing against Matheson, the son of Richard Matheson, but there are some things in this thing that you kind of put together everything quite quickly. And I think, like, when she goes, oh, go this route, journey thing, and it's also like, oh, she's guilty. There's something, because there's something like, oh, she starts it off sort of thing, like, oh, you could have gone this way, da-da-da-da. She does the book signing, da-da-da, and then she goes, oh, let me redo your tom-tom, and then everything like this happens. And automatically, it's like, this woman set her up. And I thought that they could have been a bit more clever with not making it so obvious. Right. There's some obvious things in here that you're thinking they could have done a bit better, but at saying that, I do like this film a lot, but I just thought to myself, there was some predictability to it that you do get with a TV movie.
Right.
Yeah. I think that it's less obvious in the book, because she's working it out more in her head.
Yeah.
So there's like the time when she actually she's like, when she comes and she gets home and she's trying to kind of like think about what do I need to do, she really rationalizes whether or not to call the cops. And then what happens is she visualizes that whole scenario and how the cops are like, oh, aren't you so-and-so? And then they start talking to each other, and she starts to go like, oh my God, now I'm going to be known not as that famous author, but the woman who was raped. Right. And then, she's like, and then she pictures the detective going, sorry, ma'am, we can't find your killer, and or your rapist, so we don't know if we can help you. This seems like another cold case. So she rationalizes all these things out in her head in the story, whereas this, she quickly is like, this is what I'm going to do. I have to figure this out. What happens is, I think she first goes, well, I was sent on that route because of this woman. Why would she do that? Right. And so then she starts to figure out, well, why would this woman send me this way? And then she starts to put two and two together. And it almost like builds up really quickly. Like, she figures it out.
Why did that woman hate her so much? I forgot.
No, she didn't hate her. She just basically was, she knew that her sons were doing this and that that was basically was like
she was
feeding
passing
their...
out victims to her sons.
Yeah, I know she was passing out victims, but she alluded to a reason why she picked her.
She didn't like her. She basically admitted, she's like, I don't really like your novels anyways. You suck. And she just basically was like, I had someone else and they canceled. So I just figured I'd call you and you were perfect.
Okay,
like,
that's what it was. Okay.
Yeah. I think when she's criticizing her for writing and stuff like this, I think she's doing it not for the fact that, you know, she hates her. I think she's just doing it because, you know, this woman's broken into her house. I'm going to kill her. And this, you know, so basically, you know, it's a bit like, you know, if I say something horrible to you and you're going to say something horrible back, doesn't necessarily mean it. Just means that you're looking for any easy jive that you can get at someone when you're angry with someone.
I don't think she liked her because, again, it would have been like one of those things where, why her? Because she wasn't Tess wasn't a mean person. If anything, she was like, oh, thank you. You know, oh my God. She wasn't. Someone that, I want to kill you off because, you know, you're just a bitch of a person. She was having to feed her boys because she probably was afraid they're going to go kill someone locally. Right.
Well, talk about a dysfunctional, shitty mother. I mean, it's just like she broke every taboo.
Yeah, but you know that there are mothers out there that stick up for their kids. If you want to look at it in more classic terms, we over here, we had a crime syndicate called the Cray Twins. They made a movie. Tom Hardy did a movie of them, and Spandau Ballet, one's in the 80s. And Mrs. Cray, their mother, these are my boys. I'll protect my boys. Oh, my boys can't do no wrong. And even though she knows that they're going around East London and killing people, you know, don't do anything but my boys do no wrong, you know, and you see it every day. So
how delusional.
But I don't think that, you know, from what I gathered from watching this, and I've only watched this once, maybe if I watch it and repeat viewing, maybe I get more of insight into the mother. But I think that, let's say that it wasn't Tess, and let's say that the other author did show up, the other author would have been in Tess's shoes. I don't think it's like, oh, I'll get this writer over here and then my son can kill her. I think it's like my son's, because what she says basically is that I can read the signs, and I read the signs and I know that it was time. And because it was time, Tess happened to be there. Right. And that was it.
Yeah.
Now if the other writer showed up, it probably would have been the other writer and not Tess, because Tess would have been anywhere near there. It would have been whoever was, you know, there. It was an opportunity sake, I think, more. That was the opportunity. That was it.
And she was also a pretty woman, too, so it would give them what they would want. You know, they're like, oh, it's like, you know, grade A beef for them, you know.
Right.
But I did say that there was some interesting things that I do like Tess, and I think Maria Bello is one of these unsung, fantastic actresses. Yeah. I mean, anyone that can make Coyote ugly interesting is...
Yeah.
I know.
You know, they're pretty good. And even if you see her in other films like A History of Killing with Viggo Mortensen.
Yeah, that was an excellent movie.
And she plays the wife in that. And hell, even her quick turn, blink and you miss her turn in Romeo and Juliet, the Baz Luhrmann film. She's, you know, she always shines in everything she does.
She does. She really but is unsung.
But if you take the character of Tess, when she does show up for the book signing and when the women are talking to her and stuff like this, there is an air as like, I can't believe I have to do this, which is quite interesting because you can read this two ways. It's like, oh my God, this is a writer that has to put up with this sort of stuff. And then at the end of the day, there is a bit of disrespect to her fans because at the end of this, these are the people buying your books. And so there is this thing that I think she feels that you almost get the sense that she feels that she might be slightly better than they are.
Because I think it's like small town versus like Connecticut. Cause I think she lives in Connecticut, right? Cause that's where the car took her back to.
She hasn't, yes, her home's in Connecticut. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's very Stepford, rich bitch wife, you know, right? Well to do. And then you're coming to like a small town.
She does live in a house that I want. And I do like her lifestyle. So me and Tess got that.
Love her kitty. Her kitty was so cute.
Yeah.
Her cat was fantastic.
But did you ever notice though, in movies like this, they always make the mistake, especially the villains. They either talk too much or they take photographs. It's like,
well,
I'm going to ask.
I think it's, you know, but they, at the end of the day, these are serial killers, and serial killers do take trophies.
Yeah, you're right.
But then again, I'm not sure if you would actually put these trophies on your wall. You know what I mean? You tend to like hide these, but you know, I mean, it's quite, you know, with the test situation when she's doing her book signing and talking about her books. You can look at it two ways though, because there is that thing where an author or a actor or a director has to meet their fans and what they have to put up with as well. So yeah. So that kind of contradicts a little bit about whether she thought she was too good for them. Because I imagine that if you do a lot of these things, this is probably the norm for you. And so people saying the same thing over, I got a book that I got written. Would you like to read it sometime? Or I've written a synopsis. Or I got the perfect book in me. Do you want? I mean, when I was running the literary agency, I get that all the time. You know, I'd be at parties or out to dinner with people, and they would meet me and they go, "What do you do?" I go, "Well, we own a literary." "Oh, I have this really good idea for a book." And go, "Oh God, here we go."
Interesting though is she's not like Paul Sheldon from Misery. She's not that she's done with. She loves what she writes, so she loves the knitting club. So there's a difference there that she's. I don't think when she's going to meet her fan club, I think she actually genuinely loves doing it because she loves the stories that she's writing, yeah. You know, versus if it's Paul Sheldon who having to go and talk about Misery, he's literally in misery. He's like, "Oh God, I have to talk about this story that I just want to end and be over with." You know, I think it'd be a different way, you know, to me.
It's probably a bit like James Patterson with his Alex Cross series. I mean, he writes other stuff besides Alex Cross, but it always has to go back to Alex Cross, doesn't it? So I can understand.
Yeah, true.
I can understand that side of it. I do find, but she was writing other kinds of novels as well, because when they showed her bookshelf, there was all the women's knitting circle books, but then it looked like there was other kind of books that she was writing as well underneath her name as well. So
yeah, but I think it's like she's known for
her money's that, I guess, you know. It's a bit like, you know, most writers, you know, they're always gonna be known for a series of books, but then they'll write the odd one off, but it's actually the series of books that keeps their money coming in, sort of thing. Yeah, I mean, there are some weird things in here, though. I mean, there's some characters that come and go, and you're kind of going, like, the girl next door. At first, it's like, oh, there's a really good... I have to be honest, because I've seen the poster of the film before I saw the film. When I was first watching the film, I saw Maria Bella, I was like, okay, she's going to die, and then somehow the next-door neighbor is going to get involved.
Because
if you look at the poster of this movie, it doesn't look like the next-door neighbor. It doesn't look like Maria Bella on the poster whatsoever.
No, not at all, yeah.
And I thought, oh my God, what's Ellen Page doing in this film? But
seriously, right?
And so what do you know, as with most things now, because I didn't read anything about this film at all until I just watched it, and it's like, okay. And the only thing I knew about it, you know, when I was putting everything together for, you know, the website and everything else, and you know, basically all I have is the poster, and I read about it and do my little blog sort of thing, but I don't know anything about this film, because, you know. And so when I put that out there, I was like, okay, well, you know, got this Ellen Page lookalike sort of thing, and then I watched the movie. It's like, okay, you're Marie Bello, now she's getting raped, okay. And then when she's in the drain pipe and she's alive, I was like, oh,
that was disturbing, because I mean, that is like I don't do dead bodies either.
Imagine reading that, because that was like, I thought she was literally going to die. Like, I thought like, oh, she's going to die. And then I was like, where's the story going to go? And then it's like, it almost is broken up in many chapters. When she like blacks out and she wakes up, it's like a body floating over her. That's what wakes her up.
Well, I have to sit there and say, if we're going to put this in the realistic sense, that what she should have gone for is some antibiotics, because she would have sepsis.
She's
in stagnant water with corpses and with open wounds.
Yeah.
So she would have had more than an STD. She had to worry about it.
How they tied back that one character that, you know, who apparently had left town.
Oh, yeah.
That remember? So she was like, Joan Jett's character was like, Betsy was like, oh, you know, she left town, never looked back, and never even heard from her again. And that when you see the photo, you're like, ooh. Yeah.
Well, I have to say, I didn't connect that, because I connected at the end, of course. So that made sense at the end. But when she looked at her and she says, Hope Lang, and she goes, oh, you know, she was a singer. And it's like, okay, well, and Stephen King land, is she now a famous recording artist? So she says, because the way that was propositioned, because Tess goes, I'm going to call her Hope Lang. I don't know what her character is. It was Hope something or other. I'll call her Hope Lang because it's easier to remember. But she goes, Hope Lang sang here. She goes, yeah, she sang here and never looked back. So I thought like maybe Hope Lang was like a famous recording artist.
That's what I was thinking.
Because I didn't connect that was the body that was floating there because this woman had red hair and I don't remember anyone on redheaded.
No, it was in the picture. So when she was getting the picture from the printer, when she looked up, she saw other pictures of women, and one of the pictures was a woman with red hair. You just saw the back of her hair.
Wasn't that scene when she, because you see Joan Jett, and then she's asking about who the person is, but she doesn't see the pictures of any of the murder victims until afterwards.
Correct. No, but that's what I'm saying. She sees the picture in the bar, right? Oh, yeah. My God, that's Hope, whatever. Yeah, she left town, whatever. Then when she goes and sees the pictures being printed.
Oh yeah, I
understood
that.
She looks up and she sees the picture and she's like, oh my God, like that's her. Yeah. And then she ends up, I think she writes on the back like,
oh yeah, is, no, I recognize know, Hope, that whatever. Bit of it. It's just that when she mentioned her at the beginning, because the thing is, you don't know anything about this Hope person. I thought maybe she was a famous recording artist. That's why Tess pointed out. Oh, that's
what I was thinking too.
Because it's just the way it was positioned. I mean, of course, it does swing back around. It does make sense later on. But when she first mentioned her, I thought, okay, she's a famous singer. That I happened to play at this bad, beer joint. Sort of thing. So that's why I was like, oh, okay. Wow. And then I kept wondering, like, how the hell does she know about Hope Lang? I was like, well, it's like, oh, how did she, out of the other picture on the wall, why did she point that one out? You know what I mean? Sort of thing. But then I guess if she's floating next to you dead, I guess you probably, you know, that's something another director probably would have focused on, maybe.
She also had said something like, too, like, oh, this doesn't seem like your type of place to hang out in, you know, right? You know, that remember she was like, why were you here? And she just was like, oh, you know, I got into a fight with my boyfriend. And that's sort of how, and then when she kind of looks up and sees that photo, I think it's almost like, well, you, by appearance, you don't think Tess is a rocker or likes rock music, whatever. You look at her and she looks like a little Stepford, you know?
Now, what's quite interesting is that when Isaac and I finished watching this movie, we had a quite interesting conversation. Now, we know that the brother was involved. Okay, we know that he was part of it, taking pictures and whatnot. But let's just say the brother wasn't involved, but he knew. And let's say, and the mother didn't actually, you know, that she knew. And let's just say that Tess kills them for knowing because they're kind of like unwilling accomplices. And do you think that she would have the right to kill them? Let's sit there and say that they knew about it, but they didn't do anything about it. Would she have the right to kill them?
I would say from a vigilante thing, because the amount of people who were killed and you're willingly participant, then I would say yes.
No, I'm saying that you're not a willing participant, but you know about it.
No, but I'm saying you know about it. You're not stopping it.
Yeah. Isaac's understanding is like, it goes, you might've known about it, but because they're family and you don't get involved, you're not taking part in it. You're not holding anyone down. You're not getting
But a guilt by association though, basically though, you know, well, they're doing it. So it's still wrong.
No, and it's also like, say someone like this. So this also leads into the other story, which is a good marriage, because a good marriage is in the same book. And it's exactly this. A woman who finds out her husband is a serial killer.
Right.
And she has to make a choice. Do I become a willing participant in this and stand by him and let him continue to do this and know that all these victims that he has driver's license in a box and she knows these are all missing women. She knows that he killed them basically. Now, do I take their driver's license and take them to the police station? So do I turn my husband in? Or do I sit idly by and participate? Like, so for her, it's like that story is such a great story. I won't give up what sort of happens in it. But I feel like if you're willing, you are a willing participant because you're not stopping it from happening. And then those people who have died, it's on you too. Like, you could have stopped the next person from being killed, but you chose not to, you know?
Now, suppose that you find out your brother's a killer.
Well, yeah.
That's a conversation Isaac
if
had.
If I found out my brother was a killer, I would still turn him in. I would, because I couldn't live with the fact that he would then do it to someone else. Like, it's like, you don't know the person's impulse to why they do it, and it's not for you to really figure that out, because I'm not, like, a psychologist, but... what I do know is they will do it again. There's nothing that's stopping them from not doing it again.
But suppose a vigilante comes along and they knew that you knew, and that's sit there and say that you haven't gotten around to the cops. Does the vigilante have a right to kill you?
That I knew.
Legally, you do. Well, you know, you don't have the right to take a life, but you.
Well,
know,
vigilante. No, but we're.
Well, no, but
this is the conversation Isaac and I are having, and I'll tell
but
you
no,
what.
My, but so this,
I'll
this
tell
is
you what.
The thing
I'm
is
giving
like
you Isaac's. Can, I'm giving you Isaac's views on this. I'll tell you what my views are after that. So. But,
well, no, I was just saying, because I think, like, to me, it's like if let's say someone knocked on my door and said, "I know you know your brother's killing people, right?" Mm. And like. Okay, and then they're here to kill me. I'd be like, okay, but I wasn't involved in it. But you know, I would say, but you're not even letting me have a chance to do anything with that. Mm-hmm. And rationalize with that person, like, are you going to just kill me now without letting me try to stop him from doing this? Or, you know, my thought is like, if you're rationalizing whether or not someone knew about it and then chose to hold on to that information, and then let's say it happens again, and you go, oh my God, my brother did it again. Oh my God. Like, what am I going to do? How, you know, and if that's the case and that happened, then I'd be like, yeah, I guess you're going to have to shoot and kill me because I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything to stop it. You know, especially if it's the next victim's person, right? Like, imagine I am like, I'm grieving over losing someone. And I find out that my best friend knew that the person that killed I would be like, oh my God, like, you know, you knew, you know, and you didn't do anything right to stop it.
Because I think that, and this is where, luckily, because the thing is, when she kills the brother, and, you know, and the thing is, and, you know, I know that we find out later that he was involved, but at that time, she didn't know he was involved. It was like a mistaken identity sort of thing. I mean, thank God he was involved, because that way, you know, kind of, she doesn't have to feel the guilt.
Well, she was going to kill herself, wasn't she? Because she thought she got the wrong person.
Because my view with when Isaac and I were having this conversation was like, well, you know, I'm sorry, but if you're anywhere near the vicinity and you're there, you deserve to die. That's my view. I mean, I don't care. If I was in that position, I would, you know, even if a homeless person was walking across the parking lot, I probably would have shot them. Just because it's like, you're in the vicinity. I'm sorry, but I'm here for retribution. I don't care who the hell you are.
You're like, I'm taking anyone out. Like, all of a sudden,
well, so
the
Isaac's
man comes
not
to get
for retribution.
Take a collection, and he's like, shoot them.
Well, Isaac was understanding that he understood about the rape and the female. He said that the only thing that he didn't like about the film, which is quite interesting, is that when it came to the part of Tess, he goes, the only reason why she's getting retribution, that she didn't turn anybody in to get law, is because she was worried about her writing career and how it would affect her writing career and her personal persona. Where if she spoke out against rape and was a victim of rape, and she could have used her platform to further the understanding of rape and be able to and do a more fuller understanding and have a survivor instinct and maybe change laws and things like this, because she would have that platform because she had the famous part of it, which I thought was quite interesting. He came up with that because me, I just watched it. It's like, yeah, she got right. She got retribution. Go, you go, girl. You go, girl.
No, he is right, because she does make a comment about that. You know, she makes a comment in the film about how, oh, great, like, this is really going to destroy my writing career. So she does, it is that, partially for her.
Well, I don't think it would have, I mean, to be honest, I think, you know, it gives us a retribution story sort of thing, but you know, I can understand where Isaac's coming from, because if you are famous and something like this horribly, you do survive this sort of thing, that you probably be able to help a lot more people. And I don't think it would ruin your writing career. If anything, you probably end up getting more readers, because you're, you know, it's not it's not a Me Too thing where, you know, it's a gray area here. I mean, this is a black and white kind of story. But I thought that was quite interesting, that this is what he took away from the movie. So I thought that was quite an interesting turn on this. Yeah. He doesn't normally the films that we cover, he kind of watches and goes, or whatever. But it was quite interesting that he actually, you know, came up with some interesting things. He was like, okay, because we had a conversation, which we don't normally do. We tend to watch the film and like, okay, I got work in the morning, let's go to bed sort of situation.
One of my favorite lines is when Dorian, when she looks at her and she's like, what does she say? She says, oh, you know what you have to do now, don't you? And she's like, what? And then she's like, waste him. Or what does she say? She's like kill him.
If I had Olympia Dukakis as my imaginary friend trying to tell me to kill my rapist, I would probably do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I sound like I'm trashing this film, but I actually do like this film a lot. But I have to sit there and say that I kind of wish that the Tom talking and the Olympia Dukakis character and all that came up after she was raped. And they came up, you know, they became visualized more like that. Because she's having a conversation with Tom, and Tom is answering her.
Right. I forgot about that.
Before anything happens to her. So therefore, yeah. It's like, you know, and she does see them in the window. So obviously they're part of, you know, they're so part of her life that she actually sees them and we visually see them. Where I think that if we didn't see any of that until after the rape and then Tom started having conversations with her and then the Women's Circle Club and Olympia Dukakis showed up after the rape, I think that it would have made more sense to me because if this was filmed differently, let's sit there and say that this was filmed like Last House on the Left or I Spit on Your Grave or something a bit more gritty and dirty. And then you have this going on, you would think right away, oh, this one is nuts. She's crazy. Yeah. And then another kind of film, you would think, well, did the rape really happen or is this in her head? Because already she's off kilter because she's having a conversation with her GPS system. It's answering her back. Yeah. You know, sort of thing.
Who would have thought that Lifetime would actually have a movie that had such a brutal rape? I really, seriously, other than full frontal nudity, they didn't spare you much. I mean,
I'm surprised there wasn't Christmas trees and snow.
Yeah. Well, that too.
That's normally what you get with Lifetime. Every Christmas time is like, it's Christmas, 24-hour Christmas.
That's why I got confused with Hallmark.
The series that they did was Flowers in the Attic. And I was actually surprised how graphic some of that was. Like, I was like, whoa.
Exactly.
Like, and I watched each of the series, I mean, each of the movies, and I was just like, whoa. And that, I wasn't a big fan of Heather Graham, but I think she did an okay job in that series. But it was the girl that's the lead in it, the boy, like the two of them were just fantastic. And it was,
painful. Sabrina?
Sabrina. Yeah.
But
she was the younger
version of her.
I forget her name. Cause she pulls off being a teenager for like ever. I mean, in her life existentially, you know?
I mean, the only problem with the Flower in the Gaddick series is that there's a lot good about them. It doesn't help that Kathy is different in every movie, every book, and even the Heaven series sort of thing. And then they've done the whole B.C. Andrews Heaven series now as well. That's out there now. I think that the only thing that they do suffer from is I think that they could have gone a bit better with some of the casting choices, sort of thing. You know, except like if Heather Graham does an okay job, but I think they could have done better. And the grandmother.
Yeah,
could have been better, you know. But besides that, I mean, but it was quite good to see something that was more true to the book than the original movie that with Kirstie Swanson and Louise Fellowship.
Right. Yeah.
And this, by the way, was very true to the novella. I mean, it was one of these, you know, where it hit the spots of that story. I just felt like reading it was very different for me because it just felt more like I felt like I was right with her, and it was like just this very uncomfortable feeling.
Well, that's why I say that, that's why I asked about if it was a direct adaptation, because there are things that would work in the writing that in this film, they don't quite work. And that has to be the Olympia Dukakis character showing up. And I do love her. I think she's fantastic. And it's so good to see her. And I did enjoy her performance. But if let's sit there and say that it wasn't Olympia Dukakis in this, and let's sit there and say it was another actress. And the Tom speaking at her and, you know, that kind of thing. And then I'm not sure if it would have worked in the same kind of frame kind of story because it's been too literal. But I have to, you know, my hat's off to the director. It does work in this. But yeah. I do think that if you had other actors, let's say you had lesser actors in it, would it have worked the same way? It would have been kind of odd. But say before, it does work. I enjoy it.
I think it gives you a break from her constantly talking to herself, because otherwise you'd have the whole film her rationalizing what's happening, what's going on. Because she's not interacting with anyone. She interacts with her neighbor a little bit. And obviously then, you know, the woman with the book to do the signing. But after that, it's only her. And she's only talking to herself.
Right.
You know, so you're kind of like, you have to have a way of breaking. I think that's brilliant that you have her talking to her characters, talking to the tom-tom, you know, like she's like talking to herself, mentally working things out. Then she's internalizing and externally, you know, talking it out. So
I do sit there and say, though, there are some things that I think that the script or the director could have been a bit more clever about. And the simple fact that her fingerprints are everywhere.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
she's touching everything.
But technically, you got to beat a database, though.
My problem was that she, as a crime novelist, you know this too, like she goes and washes the blood off of her face. She had gloves on. So for the most part, her gloves, like she doesn't have her fingerprints, but her hair and her DNA is going to definitely be there. Because she washed the blood off of her face from the woman. And I'm thinking, are you not worried about getting your hair in the sink or, you know, your skin in the sink, you know?
Well, there's even the female cop when the she sneaks over to the truck and then she sneaks back to her car and the female cop right there, there's a trace there. So, because I mean, that night, the person who's driving that truck or the brother or whatever, they're going to end up dead. And the mother's going to end up dead. And, you know, this woman who's famous and written a book, and this woman did recognize her. It's kind of like the scene, like, sneaking up to the truck and sneaking back away from the truck. So it's like, sort of thing. I mean, I do understand why
she wasn't spotted, though, was she?
The female cop did.
She was. The cop saw her. Yeah.
And
the cop was like, oh, so what are you doing out here? Oh, what did she say? I got lost. And then she goes, oh, well, why are you over by the truck? And she had a good reason. She said something.
But at the same time, you can have a really good reason. But when that person ends up dead later on that night, you're
like, yeah.
The whole family.
Though, you know, here's the other thing. She could get away from it from the simple fact that the police and maybe have known these brothers have been doing something bad and haven't been able to prove it. Right. Well, she could get away. She probably got away with it because the small town cops, as a woman, she was a female cop. She could have been like, good, they're finally dead. Right. And I probably know who did it, but they're never going to find out. Right. Oh, so they died. Oh, well, you know.
Like, well, to be honest, with the severity of the case, and there's, you know, a serial killer, the family of the serial killer, the serial killing family basically are dead. You know, let's face it, it's going to, I mean, that small town is not going to be able to contain that story. I mean, that's going to be every podcaster's dream, isn't it? It's going to talk about true crime. And, you know, and next thing you know, it's like, you know, families who kill, the Netflix crime investigation channels doing a special one-off.
Yeah, did she send the photos to the families of the women that were killed?
Yeah. So she's, you know, so even though she scrubbed her, she found her cell phone, later on down the road, you know, but then again, maybe the police are going, oh, she did us a service. You never know.
Yeah.
I just thought it was a fucking badass movie, though. I just love it when women kick serious ass after being violated numerous ways. So, I mean, yeah. It's definitely chalk one up for victims and women, you know? I mean, just like, not to literally take it laying down.
Well,
so,
personally, I think that anyone that takes the law into their own hands should be killed. That's personally my views.
When it comes to this shit, because people like these assholes walk.
Yeah.
I have to sit there and say, it's quite, I mean, I like the film. So, I mean, I know that I've been like, finding little holes and stuff like this. But if I'm just like trying to compare it to like, if I went to the movie theaters and saw this, I think I would be assessing it differently, but watching it on TV where it's meant to be watched, I think that's why it works for me, sort of thing.
Yeah.
Because I did enjoy it. And I said before, Joan Jett fucking rocks. We need more.
I know. Why isn't she in more movies? Seriously.
I don't know.
But she, I know. She's amazing.
I mean, she's kind of, she almost steals the film in that one scene that she has. She's like,
well, it was a very significant scene, though, when you look at back on the movie, because there was some, there was, what's the word I want to use? Not recognition, but there's somebody knows what's going on. I mean, vindication, maybe.
Yeah, but I do think that if you gave that to, let's sit there and say, you know, let's give it to Paris Hilton to do. You know, saying the same lines, doing the same thing.
It wouldn't be the same. No.
But I'm sitting there saying that she just demands your attention. As soon as she shows up, and even the way that she delivers her lines, the way that she acts, she just demands your attention. And she, I'm not saying she outshined everyone else in the film, but to be up against Olympia Dukakis and Maria Bello and to stand your freaking own, she bloody did it. But even the mother of the serial killer, who August, she's fantastic as well. You see her in plenty of stuff. She always plays like the country neighbor who has all the answers but a bit fun, or there's something diabolical about her. She's able to play those two kinds of roles, and she's fantastic as well.
I love that she got the last line, Joan Jett, too, at the end when she calls, because I just thought that was really smart and funny. Like, you know, her, I know what you did. You could be a girl.
But right. I have to give it a shout out to Ann Dowd as well, because I mean she's fantastic. Every time she appears in something, you notice her. I keep on sitting there and saying that she was a mystic pizza or something.
And I love that in that scene, like you really don't know if she knew. You know, when she confronts her, she's like, "Oh, by your face, looking at your face, you knew. You know, you're surprised I'm alive." And the way you could take that scene as, no, she's just surprised that she's got a gun and pointing it at her, you know? Mm-hmm. And you kind of are like, oh my God, is she going to kill this woman that she's innocent? And then when it flips and then she admits it, you're just like, oh, kill her. Kill her ass.
Yeah.
I mean, Anne Dowd, who I was mentioning, who plays the mother of the serial killer. I mean, you'll recognize because she was in the Handmaid's Tale. She plays Aunt Lydia in that.
Oh.
And she's like so much stuff, you know. She does.
I still have not gotten to watch that. Not the series, but the movie itself. But there's a series, isn't there?
Yeah, there's a series of it.
I just haven't brought myself to do that one yet. I'm trying.
I watched the first season, and after that, I was like, okay.
Yeah.
I know where this is going?
I guess. Yeah. I don't know.
I know the author of the book.
Right.
Margaret Atwood. So I've had dinner with her a couple times. She's a nice woman. So, okay. Well, we've come to a lull.
I was going to say we've now hit our final thoughts. I mean, I think we both are all
final thoughts. Said, you know, John likes rape movies.
John likes torturing his fellow podcast co-host with rape porn.
Rape porn. Yeah, John's secret. What do you call it? Secret guilty treasures. Rape porn.
What I find interesting is the way this movie sets up for the test character. There's another short story that he did in the companion book of this.
It coincides with this.
Because it's about a woman who's a runner, and so there's a scene where she's running, and I thought, oh my God, they should do that one with her, the same character, but it's a completely different character. It's not Tess, but it's about a runner who just is very observant about her environment, and it's somewhere in Florida, I think it's Coral Gables, and she sees someone that she knows is a serial killer. And she starts to kind of like follow them to determine what their next moves are, because she knows that there's something wrong, and she gets caught in the trap, basically. And then it's how do you work your way out of it now?
And, well, you know, movies like this, I think, are like anxiety attacks for me, because you know where this movie is going. And you know that she's going to have this horrible situation of which she just doesn't seem to be able to extricate herself from immediately. And these kind of movies just give me panic attacks. They just do, because you know, it's like, this is going to fucking suck. And you know, all these horrible things are going to happen. So.
But it's nice to have that vindication at the end, when, especially with her, you know, what she went through.
I
anything I've...
It does have a happy ending to it, so.
Yeah. If there is anything I have learned from these two films, it is that justice has many shapes and forms, revenge being one of them. And sometimes that is the only thing a person who has been assaulted needs. The comfort of knowing that an assailant can never do what they did to someone else. Though when you cross that line, is there ever going back? Speaking of going back, make sure to head back on over to our website at llpodcast.com to check out all of our past episodes, become a patron, and read our reviews of books to screens and everything in between. For our next episode, we will be discussing the film The Devil's Backbone. Until then, we'd like to thank you for downloading, liking, and sharing the Literary License Podcast. Until next time, folks, bye.
Bye.
Bye, everybody.
If you even start to yell, I will shoot. And you better believe me, bitch.
Why would you shoot me? And you fire that gun and the whole neighborhood is going
to
hear you.
Oh, won't matter to you because you'll be dead. Back up. Over there. You just be a good girl and answer my questions, and maybe you'll still be alive tomorrow. Do you hear me?
Like Leo in The Revenant, Abel in that Bible bit. Revenge is sweet, isn't it? Really, really hope for it. I know that it won't fix a thing. Song like this that I could sing for you. All the feels you make me do, nightmare fucking coming true. Wish I was a lawyer, I would sue you. Sue you, take your dog, take your house, take your shoes, take your heart. Now here comes that singing part. I'm daydreaming, let me count the ways. How I'll get you, oh how I'll make you pay. Babe, I'm hurting, and now you'll feel the same. That's my plan, that's my plan, that's my plan. Mm-hmm. We could do revenge, 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 revenge. Together, together, together. We could take revenge, revenge, revenge. Revenge is sweet. We could do revenge, 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 revenge. Together, together, together. We could take revenge, revenge, revenge. Revenge is sweet.
Now here's where girlfriends come in hand, especially those that understand. Crime's a crime, but listen, man, really cannot give a damn. We've all been through this kind of thing. Say the word, we make it sting for him. He can't just get away with it. Eye for eye, you piece of. You treat us like a garbage pit. Let me at him. Wait for it, wait for it, wait for it. Here's that singing part again. I'm daydreaming. Let me count the ways. How I'll get you. Oh, how I'll make you pay. Babe, I'm hurting. And now you'll feel the same. That's my plan. That's my plan, that's my plan. Mm-hmm. We could do revenge, 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 revenge. Together, together, together. We could take revenge, revenge, revenge. Revenge is sweet. We could do revenge, 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 revenge. Together, together, together. We could take revenge, revenge, revenge. Revenge is sweet.
Well, in the beginning, we felt like we was meant to be. I fell for you and skinned my knee, but hell with any injury. Eventually, you'll get up gingerly. Feels like it'll take a century to heal, but just know that I will. But fuck trying to make amends, I'd rather take revenge. You're sticking safety pins inside my atrium. Your day begins at 8 p.m., you hit the ATM in my Mercedes-Benz with all your lady friends. Horse. Hit the club and you go out, don't know a sum. Cause when I calculate the times you cheated and I total up all the amounts, it doesn't add up. Cause you say then just giving out your number doesn't count. Get it? Then see me with someone new, get mad and flip it. Look how bad you spin it. First you turn your back on me, then tell me that I stabbed you in it. Stabbed you in it.
Stabbed you in it.
Stabbed you in it.
Stabbed you in it.
Slut!
So when you're driving to his house, and you pass me while I'm driving to hers, just remember you cheated on me first. You're a whore, you're a whore. This is war,
fellas, ladies.
We can do revenge, 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 revenge. Together, together, together. We can take revenge, revenge, revenge. Revenge is sweet,
so sweet.
We can do revenge, 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 revenge. Together, together, together. We can take revenge, revenge, revenge. Revenge is sweet.
Fuck yeah.
No! No! Don't lie to me.
You thought I was dead.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Just fess up, you sick bitch.